Hi everyone. Today's tech tip video will focus on Teknic's Regressive Auto-Spline, or RAS for short, and how it can help improve your machine performance and machine throughput. At this point, many of you are probably wondering what the RAS even is. Teknic's Regressive Auto-Spline is a proprietary smoothing algorithm that applies a fourth-order polynomial curve to your incoming velocity versus time command, which creates a jerk-limited and jerk-derivative-limited motion profile. So, instead of having an abrupt change when going from a standstill to an instantaneous acceleration rate, the RAS actually rounds this transition point by creating a gradually increasing acceleration rate up to the acceleration limit. In other words, these points of inflection or these transition points in a motion profile get rounded out, creating a much more mechanically friendly profile, meaning the mechanics are not being asked to instantaneously start-stop, they're being asked to gradually ramp up to a given acceleration rate and gradually slow down to a specific velocity or zero velocity. So your mechanics will go from this to this with a click of a button. Before we move on to get into more detail about how the regressive auto-spline actually works and the reason it's able to provide such incredible benefits to your motion system, I do quickly want to point out the differences that you would see amongst different ClearPath series, specifically the ClearPath MC and ClearPath SD. Right now we're using a ClearPath MC PV. So it does have a motion controller built into it, and because it knows the acceleration and the velocity, it's actually able to sculpt these commands and automatically generate a RAS setting. So as you'll see right here, all you have to do is click on this drop-down menu, and you just choose if you want a little bit of smoothing, medium smoothing, or high smoothing, a lot of smoothing. This differs from a ClearPath SD, in that the ClearPath SDs do not have the motion controller built into them. So they don't have that prerequisite knowledge to be able to create an auto-generated RAS feature, right? So with the SD series, what you have to do is you're actually choosing a numerical value to set your smoothing. So you might see something like 4 milliseconds or 16 milliseconds. And essentially all you'd be doing is clicking one or the other, and it's going to actually smooth out your motion profile by that amount of time. Obviously, the higher the number is, the more smoothing you get, the more rounded these corners look. So essentially it's working the exact same way. The only difference is that with the MC series, it automatically calculates what that smoothing should be, and in terms of the numerical value for how much amount of time is used for that smoothing, is automatically done in the MC series. So it really just makes it that much easier for the user to set these values appropriately. So a lot of you probably have already used some sort of smoothing algorithm in another servo system, and you might be thinking right now, so what's the big deal? I've used servo systems in the past, and they've had some sort of smoothing algorithm built in. Maybe it was cosine smoothing or an S-curving. So basically, the RAS is the same thing, right? The RAS is much more advanced than something like S-curving or cosine smoothing. To show you what I mean, let's actually zoom in on a motion profile. Let's get a standard trapezoidal move going right now, and we'll save it on the screen. Now that we have the scope trace saved here, what I want to do is actually zoom in on one of these points of inflection, specifically right here, where we're going from instantaneous but constant deceleration to instantaneously stopping. So as you can imagine, any sort of abrupt change like that is going to be very difficult, and those of you who are really familiar with mechanics know that you cannot stop anything instantaneously. Even with electronics, things cannot happen instantaneously, right? There's always some sort of mechanical or electrical time constant. Imagine if you were running at a sprint and you just had to stop. You couldn't slow yourself down. You were just running at a sprint and you had to plant your feet and stop. You'd probably tumble pretty hard. So the same exact principles, right, these sorts of physics would apply to motion control and mechanics as well. So what's really important is to actually evaluate these systems in the torque domain, meaning we are commanding this motion profile we see, but what's the motor actually doing from a torque standpoint, right? That's really what's going to dictate smooth motion, quick settling, and all these sorts of important and pertinent features for any machine. But if we look at this torque trace, and we see that we have the end of the trap move right above it, right? So this is actually happening the exact same time, right? You see that as the motor is at the slanted trajectory in the velocity versus time profile, again, a constant deceleration rate, you'll see that the torque is constant right here, which makes sense, right? We're not telling it to do anything different. We're saying, hey, maintain a specific acceleration. So in the torque domain, you're going to maintain a specific torque. Now what you'll see, though, is that when we get to the point where we're about to go from deceleration to zero speed or zero velocity, we see a straight line right here. That's us telling the motor from a torque standpoint that you need to instantaneously hit the brakes and stop. Now, again, if we think of that running analogy where you're running at a sprint and you need to stop without slowing down, you just plant your feet. Again, right, your body's going to be exposed to a lot of forces. If you don't fall, things are going to shake pretty violently. But again, as you can see from a mechanical standpoint, that's going to create a lot of instability, a lot of ringing at the end of the move. So what we're seeing is that in the torque domain, we have very sharp inflection points, which is not something we want. That's obviously not something that's going to lead to smooth motion, right? That's something that's not going to help your mechanics, right? You don't want to be hitting the mechanics hard every time you see a spike like this in the torque domain. You could imagine that you're hitting the machine with a hammer, right? So again, it's not good for the longevity of the mechanics. The motor itself is going to run hotter. It's not going to run as efficiently. And clearly the motion itself can look very bad, right? You can get a lot of ringing and take a lot of time to move and settle. So it's pretty obvious that with a standard trap move with no smoothing and or no smoothing applied, that the motion and the torque response, they look very abrupt. They look very rough. Definitely not something that's mechanically friendly. This is why most servo systems have some sort of smoothing algorithm, whatever it may be, cosine smoothing, S-curving, again. They have some way to help make the motion profile that the mechanics and motor need to follow to make it less abrupt. So I think what makes sense then is to actually show the trapezoidal move that has the first degree of smoothing, which is just jerk-limited smoothing. Again, we're looking at the same point in the profile where we're hitting deceleration to a constant velocity. In this case, it'd be zero velocity. But as you can see, just from the motion profile itself, it looks much smoother than the trap move, right? We don't have that really sharp corner when you're about to hit your endpoint where you need to stop decelerating and literally be at zero velocity. You can see it starts to curve a little bit. But again, the proof is really going to be in the torque domain because what's more important is how the motor is using its torque, right? If it's using it very efficiently versus is it using it in the fashion of a trapezoidal move where it's got a lot of sharp angles, a lot of sharp points where we're instantaneously asking for it to, you know, start decelerating and then to stop. So if we pull up the torque curve of the jerk limited profile that we're looking at right now, again, these are lined up perfectly in time. So where you see at the very beginning of the commanded velocity versus time motion profile on the far left, it looks like that slope is pretty constant, right? It looks like that's a constant deceleration portion, which if we look at the torque command, that is exactly what's happening, right? We see that torque is flat because we are saying, hey, decelerate at a constant rate. Now, the interesting part with the jerk limited profile is that once you see in the velocity versus time command, when it starts to get very close to touching down to its commanded position, it actually starts to curve a little bit. So what is that doing in the torque domain? Well, in the torque domain, we see a slope that looks, again, like it's a constant slope. So this doesn't mean it's a constant deceleration or acceleration. It's a constant change to the acceleration. So while the jerk limited profile is definitely a huge improvement over the trapezoidal profile that does not have any smoothing, the torque domain is still showing us otherwise. It's still showing us that we are hitting it with instantaneous commands in terms of torque changing. And again, that's like hitting the system with a hammer. So even though this is much smoother and a greater improvement over the standard trapezoidal move, it actually still is going to lead to a motion that might look abrupt and might ring at the end of the move. So your settling time is still really not going to be all that great. Definitely better than it was with the trap move, but it's not going to be quite where many people would want or expect when they're using a high-performance servo system. So that's where the RAS comes into play. And what I would like to do is pull up a quick profile of the RAS. So this, again, is a jerk-limited and jerk-derivative-limited profile. So this is going to get a little confusing, but where the jerk-limited profile controls the rate of change of the acceleration, the RAS, which again is a jerk-limited and jerk-derivative-limited profile, controls the rate of change of the rate of change of the acceleration. So you're taking it one derivative further, one step further, which is going to, as you'll see, create an extremely smooth motion profile. And I think you'll be all pretty shocked to see what the torque actually looks like when the RAS is applied. So to do that, we need to pull up our torque profile. So let's do that right now. And as you can see, this looks incredibly different from all the other torque responses that we were looking at. So, I mean, if you just looked at the velocity versus time command of a RAS profile versus a jerk limited profile, they don't look all that much different. When you look at the torque command, though, when you look at the motor's torque response, it's night and day different. As you can see, there are no sharp inflection points, and that's because we're able to gradually increase the acceleration rate up to the acceleration limit. So whereas in a jerk-limited profile, the rate of acceleration could change, but it was a constant change, meaning if that value is set to 100 RPMs per second, it's just going to go up by 100 RPMs per second, right, until that you to the point where we touch down to hit zero velocity. With a RAS profile, it's actually gradually increasing that rate of change. So maybe it starts out at 10 RPMs per second, and then it goes up to 15 RPMs per second, and then it goes up to 20 RPMs per second, and then maybe it goes up to 35 RPMs per second, and then it goes up to 70 RPMs per second, right? It has the ability to ramp in and out at a much smoother rate, creating what you see here in the torque domain, which is a profile that looks incredibly smooth. So as you can imagine, from the motor standpoint, from the mechanic standpoint, that means the motor is going to run cooler. That means it's running more efficient. The mechanics are going to run smoother, which is going to increase the longevity of them. And then, of course, your settling time is going to be improved. You can see that they're drastically different, right? The trapezoidal move with no smoothing looks like it's outputting a square wave in the torque domain, which is not good, right? We know that that's not good. If you look at the jerk limited profile, it's better. But there's still points of inflection. It actually kind of looks like a trapezoid, which is a little ironic, but clearly you do see those points of inflection. And now if we go all the way to the RAS, you can see that it looks incredibly smooth. The points of inflection are gone. The motion itself, I mean, if you just look at this, if you just pretended this was a motion profile, this looks like it'd be a lot easier to follow than any of those other ones. So now that we all have a much better understanding of how the RAS works, the math behind it, and the benefits it provides, let's look at the motion again with and without the RAS and really kind of run this point home. So again, this is the motion without the RAS applied. As you can see, without the RAS applied, the move and settle time is not very good. If you're looking at the load, it's taking a while to ring out. So even though this move is commanded to start and stop faster in terms of its time, the amount of ringing going on is taking much, much longer than it would with the RAS applied. And let's just show you what the RAS looks like right now. As you can see, the RAS really is incredibly advanced. It's going to improve the life of your mechanics. Your motor is going to run cooler. You have more headroom in your motor, right, because you're using everything more efficiently. So you can actually accelerate harder. And ultimately, you end up increasing your throughput because the system is going to move and settle faster than it would with jerk-limited profiling or obviously with no profiling. And it was just a standard trapezoidal move. I hope this tech tips video on the regressive autospline has been helpful. If so, please click the thumbs up button and like. If you're interested in getting more information or getting a heads up on whenever we release a new video, feel free to click the Teknic logo and subscribe to our channel. You may also be interested in some of the other videos we've created, specifically the G-stop demonstration, which is related to the regressive autospline. As always, please feel free to comment and ask questions. Please don't be shy, and until next time.